Thanks, John. Thanks so much. Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you for having me here. It's really an honor and privilege every time I get to meet with customers. Many of you I know personally, and it's great to see you all, and I'm really excited to share with you ST10 along with Craig here. So there's a whole bunch of material to cover here. I'm going to give you a little bit of a roadmap. The first is next generation design. So some of you may have caught the video replay of the talk I gave in London back in March at the Develop 3D conference. And that talk was all about where is design headed? What might it do in the future? What is next generation design going to be? And the news is next generation design is here today in ST10, and we'll explain to you what we mean by that. Next is simulation. Solid Edge has great simulation tools already. We're augmenting that and taking that further, both in our stress analysis and now with built-in fluid flow analysis. Manufacturing. Obviously, Siemens is very strong in this area, and we continue to take advantage of that strength in the Solid Edge portfolio. Tech pubs, technical publications, a new area for us, brand new products to introduce to you today that will make your life a lot easier. Data management. We have customers that run the gamut from 2 seats to 200 seats plus. And we want to cover your data management needs regardless of whether it's 2 seats, 200 seats, or more. We've got that covered with ST10. We'll talk more about that today. And then finally, the Solid Edge portal. This is something very exciting we're bringing to market. And it's really trying to take this old school method of mailing around drawings, mailing around parts and assemblies, and moving this into the modern world. And we'll see how that works here in just a few minutes. So let's start off with next generation design. As John said, there's some very exciting technologies going on in the industry right now. We're going to delve into each of these in some detail. But let's start generative design. First, the generative design, the notion that you can have the computer do all the heavy lifting for you. I have these parameters, help me design the part. Second is reverse engineering. John talked about scanning and how that's growing at 10% a year compounded. And so we're seeing a lot more people taking advantage of that technology, and we've got some great tools at ST10 to help you take advantage of that. And additive manufacturing. For those of you that aren't following this super closely, notice that this has changed from 3D printing to additive manufacturing. That's one of the big things that's happened here is people are producing production parts with this. So it's manufacturing as opposed to prototyping. Now, the thing that most people don't want to talk about is the challenge that these bring to us. John alluded to it a little bit, and that is that they are disparate technologies with as far as integrated with your CAD system. So the interesting thing about all three of these, if you look at this legend down here at the bottom, mesh model in blue, BREP model in orange, these are all mesh model technologies, meaning what you get out of a generative design is a big bag of triangles that looks like a solid model. What you get out of reverse engineering is a bunch of point data that then becomes a big bag of triangles, and that's what you've got. And of course, additive manufacturing has been using triangle mesh-based technology for the last 30 or so years. So these are all mesh-based technologies that typically use a separate package to work with. Of course, what you use daily is not mesh-based technology. You use Solid Edge or some other package. And so your design is based on a BREP. That's a real geeky CAD-based way of saying a solid model that's made from a bunch of surfaces stitched together. So you obviously would like to have all these things work together. I mean, that's what we would all like to have happen, and they'd all blend seamlessly in this beautiful world that you see depicted here. But that's really not what happens, right? So you have this mesh-based model, and you get out this great mesh-based model, but I need to change it a little bit. Okay, well, good luck with that. Reverse engineering, the dirty little secret here is getting the points is not that hard. Getting the points to be into triangles is almost trivial. Turning the triangles into a surfaced BREP solid model is days and days of painful work, generally speaking. And so that's the little dirty secret of that particular technology. And then additive is letting us do so many new things, but how are we going to drive that? What kind of designs are we going to do that take advantage of additive manufacturing? And so what I want to talk to you about is how we're going to bring all these worlds together. Generative design, additive, reverse engineering, and a technology that's exclusive to Siemens that allows us to glue these together and solve this particular problem. So let's start by taking a look at generative design with Craig.
All right, thanks, Dan. So getting started, first a shout out to our customer, Bernina, who provided us with this beautiful data set of kind of the Cadillac of sewing machines. And we're going to utilize this to show the next generation of design. And the first portion we're looking at, as Dan was talking about, is generative design, essentially allowing the system to optimize this for us. It's also known as topology optimization, or just essentially lightweighting. So what we have here is a chassis that's going to hold together all of the components of our sewing machine, and we want the system to make this as optimum as possible for us. So you'll see we have some great new commands located all under the generative design tab up there, allowing you to preserve whatever features, whatever regions you need to. So whether it's holes, cuts, surfaces, whatever you want to make sure you maintain whenever you get ready to start generating this design, it's going to give you access to all of those areas. And then from that point, you essentially just tell the system how this is going to work, you know, almost like a simulation study. So where is the pressure going to be placed? Where is it going to be fixed? You know, all the action is going to be taking place where the needle assembly is. It's going to be sitting on a table. And then from that point, you just add your input values. So whenever you go into the generate, you have access to the study quality, depending on how fine you want your end mesh to be, as well as how you want to reduce the mesh, whether it's going to be a percentage, whether it's a target mass, or you can even use factor safety or stress values as well. But one of the coolest aspects of this new technology is after you run it through the generative design process, the output that you get is almost artwork, right? I mean, it's absolutely beautiful. It's very interesting to see with the eye, and you still maintain all of the functionality that you need inside of your part. So very quickly, you can run through. It's going to show you a stress diagram of how everything comes together and allows you to make those changes. Now, there's a couple of different ways in which generative design works. You can either have a portion already defined, like we did with the chassis, where you know, all of our features were in place, or you can just have a block of a part, you know, just have geometry on screen, have a couple of features that are going to come into play whenever you're placing it, and let the system do the rest. So, right, define where it's going to be located, and then allow generative design to come in and put your supports where you need them, making sure that it stands up to the stresses that it's going to be used for. So some really nice stuff there, allowing you to leverage the new additive manufacturing technologies and capabilities with these designs. And then kind of getting back to the dirty little secret associated to working with mesh models inside of a traditional CAD program is being able to make any kind of edits to this after the fact. Great thing about Solid Edge ST10 and the portfolio that it brings along with you is you get to use the same commands that we all know and love as users of Solid Edge, where you can simply include a sketch here, you got a synchronous region, grab a hold of it, pull it back and create your cut into the part, and it edits that mesh model just like its native geometry, right? So very, very powerful capability there with the new generative design capabilities inside of Solid Edge ST10 portfolio.
Super, thanks, Greg. So just to highlight a couple things here that I think are important, because I know we have a bunch of industry analysts in the room, and we, you know, generative design is a term you'll hear elsewhere in industry. A couple of really important things. The first thing is that Solid Edge Generative Design is producing a completely finished and ready to go to additive manufacturing part. The parts you see here come directly out of Solid Edge without any modification whatsoever. What you see mostly in industry is what we call inspirational design. You do the same kind of process, but it generates this kind of really ugly, crufty model that's an idea of how you can do the design. And then you design around it, and that takes you the next couple days to do. With Solid Edge, you come out the back end with the design ready to go. The other thing that I think is real interesting about this is people talk about it a lot for lightweighting. And that's, I think, what immediately occurs to people, oh, lightweighting in aerospace or automotive or something like that. The interesting thing is when we talk to customers in a, let's say, machinery area, it's about reducing material costs. Talk to a customer, Ariel, who makes the large pumping compressor stations, and they're using this type of technology to reduce material costs. They don't have any need for lightweighting. They're sitting there with a big propane compressing station. But when he looks at the fact that he can reduce the weight of his giant castings by 25%, he says, I get every fourth part for free. Now that's a powerful statement, and that's what people can get out of it. So I think I would encourage you to look at this very deeply. No matter what industry you're in, you're going to make money with this.
And if you ship those parts.
And if you ship those parts, you get reduced shipping costs, you get reduced CO2 footprint.
Yeah.
There's a whole bunch of things around that. Customers who are looking at this technology, for example, Seb. Seb is not a household name as far as the company Seb, they're in France. Their products are a household name, their brands, Krux, Tefal, Molinex, Allclad. Probably, if you made coffee this morning, or you cooked some scrambled eggs, you used something designed in Solid Edge. They're looking at this technology to improve their product line, as are many of our other customers as well. We'll certainly hear in a moment from Craig Hall, who's already using this technology to do some amazing, amazing stuff. Okay, next up is additive manufacturing, so let's take a look at that.
All right, y'all, let's talk about 3D printing. So, 3D printing has been around for a while. They've talked about it, you know, continuously being developed for the last 10 years or so. Solid Edge definitely has been supporting 3D printing processes for quite a while as well. And coming into ST10, we've done nothing but to continue to develop onto that support. And the great thing about Solid Edge and additive manufacturing or 3D printing is we give you a choice of how you want to work with your parts, right? So if you have a 3D printer at home or at your work, and you simply want to be able to print your own parts there, you simply have your CAD system, load your printer drivers onto that system. It's going to directly connect you with it, allow you to walk through this easy to understand process and print it on your own home printer. Or if you want to utilize a different material, if you want, you know, you've got your proof of your design and your plastic print, and you want to have it developed and delivered in a different material, Solid Edge automatically has an integration allowing you to basically load your part into this UI right here, shop for different print services, shop for different prices, shop for different materials that you want to output, telling you whether or not that they can print your parts, and then set up shipping, just like Amazon, right? Swipe your credit card and you have it delivered to your door whenever you're ready to have that part manufactured for you. So Solid Edge just giving you every opportunity to make sure that you can leverage this new technology and get these parts.
All right, thanks, Greg. So a couple really important things here. The first, obviously, is we know that additive is enabling us to do things we couldn't do before. So these generative designs, often the only way to produce them is through additive, and we have the technology to do that these days. You come straight out of Solid Edge and produce the parts directly to your connected printer. STL is the format that's been used for the last 30 years. 3MF is the new format. Solid Edge supports both STL and 3MF. Importantly, we now offer this service. So I'm sure everybody in the room uses Kayak or Booking.com or Trivago or some aggregator of travel options. What a great idea. I want to travel, you tell me all the different places that have different prices. Well, this is that same thing directly in Solid Edge. I don't have a 3D printer, or maybe I have a small one that does little plastic parts. I can in Solid Edge say, I want to print this out. Tell me, who are all the suppliers? What are all the prices? You click a button and say go. It will send it to that supplier. You'll have your quote instantly, and you'll get back the part a couple days later. So this is a great way for you to get into the whole additive manufacturing 3D printing thing. That's really an entree for many, many folks.
Aggregator. Travel options.
Yeah, aggregator travel options. Thank you, Craig. And we are seeing more and more customers use this. This is Kurt Joa, who's a very large machinery supplier to Procter & Gamble and other folks. Starting to use this for real production parts. And I have to tell you, I was surprised when we were at ST10 Beta talking to a couple different customers. Kim Bolden, many of you analysts spoke with yesterday. Also Bird Technologies. The size of runs they're producing with additive. So when I think of additive, the fact that it's a fairly low volume thing, I think, okay, we might produce 2 parts, we might produce 10 parts, that's kind of good. If it's a Craig Hall kind of business. These guys were producing anywhere from 200 to 1,000 parts in production into their production products because it was just the best way to do it rather than going to molds or suppliers. And so we're really starting to see this additive manufacturing take hold. All right, next up is reverse engineering. Let's take a look at that.
All right, so reverse engineering, essentially having the ability to have a part in a physical form and then create a digital model of it or a digital twin of it. What we have here is an actual Bernina sewing machine. It's a bit of an antique. We have the physical representation of it, but we want to make sure that we have that in a digital format. So using our 3D scanning technology and tools, we can simply go and scan that in and then bring it directly into Solid Edge. Now, the great part of this is if you need to make any changes, you know, we're making our 100th anniversary edition of this, we need to make a few alterations. It doesn't matter what is on the part or what is on the model, you don't even have to change the original mesh into surfaces before you can start editing this. We've got some great mesh cleanup tools. You see here, you can just fin select the mesh areas. It's going to automatically delete that out for you. And then what's even better is a fill holes option. So if you have an incomplete mesh, it's automatically going to recognize that and it's going to fill those holes in so that you have a completed version of it. Now, with reverse engineering, there's a couple of different workflows you can work with whenever you're trying to reverse engineer your products. The one that you're seeing here is a manual method. There's also an automatic method. If you're trying to completely recreate the part, you simply click on the automatic recognition and it's going to create those surfaces. On the manual method, what we're doing here, if you just want to have a couple of the different features in a BREP version so that you can assemble it inside of your top level assembly so it's in the proper location, it's very easy to do that. Simply identify what surfaces you want to create, and Solid Edge is automatically going to do that for you based on the mesh that's there. And then, of course, from that point, it's as easy as using the surfacing tools, trimming away the excess, or using the intersect command to get it in the stitched version that you want. Now, as I was saying earlier, you know, if you don't have to spend the time to go through and recreate this entire thing from scratch, you know, why would you do that? Especially when you can use Solid Edge's native commands to make whatever changes you want to. Want to cut a hole through the mesh? Create a circle. Throw it through there. It's going to create the geometry you want. And it's not just about removing material as you've seen so far. You can add material as well. So you need to throw a new part number on this thing. Simply use the commands that we all know, that we all love, that we've all used for years, and put that part number on there, and it's going to automatically merge into that mesh body and become a part of the new design that you're working with. So very powerful technology there, very powerful capabilities, and this is really cool, right? So you got a tool body, you got a target body, like you would using BREP models. You can simply subtract from one another. And then if you got a synchronous PMI dimension there, it's going to associate and maintain that target and tool body associativity. So some really, really fantastic new technology with reverse engineering and Solid Edge ST10.
All right, thanks, Craig. So I think there was a lot going on there, and we're going to have to break it down a little bit, right? So obviously we're bringing in the triangle data, but not only that, we're then operating on the triangle data as if it's BREP data, which is pretty amazing stuff. And so you can start to bring in your legacy designs and make modifications to those legacy designs. Now this is all pulled together. How is that possible? And I gotta say, it seems like, at least to me, almost magic, because what you saw feature-based modeling you're used to. You're like, oh, what the heck, it's a cutout, it's a protrusion, it's whatever. But in fact, that was happening on a mesh model. There was no BREP there at that time. And so that's the amazing stuff here and the amazing glue. And that's Siemens convergent modeling. It's what allows us to take this world of triangles that has always been off in the distance there somewhere, done with some other strange foreign tool, and take the solid models and pull that all together. And it's all done with the same commands. There's no like, do a protrusion on a mesh, do a cutout on a mesh. It's all done with the same commands. And so what you see is really that merging of the worlds that I talked about a second ago. So now, this model that we talked about at first that said, wouldn't it be amazing if that actually existed? It does actually exist thanks to convergent modeling. And so what that means is you can take that generative design and you can put the forces on and generate the design. But when you're done, if you need to add a counterboard hole or you need to stamp a part number, you can do it directly on that mesh model using the commands you are used to. Same thing with reverse engineering. As you saw in that example, Craig reverse engineered and only put on two things. He put on a mating face and an aligning face, and after that, all the rest was pure convergent mesh modeling. And then manufacturing. It's very common to get these pieces of data from a variety of different places, from GrabCAD or something else. You can take models and repurpose them using convergent technology and be able to then go to additive manufacturing directly in front of it.
And additionally, if you guys want to know more about the reverse engineering, we're having a lecture right after lunch at 1 o'clock, and we'll go through the entire process. It's really cool stuff.
Super. We're seeing our customers already adopting this. Ricardo Espinoza at Kimball. Kimball is a furniture designer and manufacturer, very well known in the world. In fact, you were sleeping in a Kimball bed last night, you were working at a Kimball desk, you have your Kimball nightstand. Everything here is designed in solid edge in your rooms. And so Kimball, though, do photorealistic stuff of their rooms and mockups. This picture you see here is not a hotel room, it's a virtual model of a hotel room. And so they need to bring in all these types of things, pillows and blankets and all sorts of facet-based models that are available on the internet, and be able to incorporate those into their design. And using convergent modeling, they can do that. We're also seeing, we have, of course, a bunch of illustrious analysts here in the room, one of whom is Chad Jackson. Chad took a look at this technology very deeply, and I think he had some great insights. And it's really about the fact that you're taking this weird, separate world of mesh modeling and bringing it all together. So instead of having solid modeling and one guy, a specialist who knows these special tools, you bring it all together, you make it fully parametric and associative, and you allow people to really get to that next level of productivity. Okay, so next generation design, but we're not quite done yet, because no discussion of next generation design would be quite complete without talking a little bit about synchronous and the other pieces of solid edge. So let's take a look at a couple things we're doing there.
Yeah, and that's absolutely right. You know, we continue to push the boundaries of modeling capabilities inside of Solid Edge. You know, this is just going to be a small subset of all the things that are available. But initially, you can see that we have a brand new draw command, freehand sketching, that you can leverage your stylus, leverage your tablet, if that's the kind of work that you enjoy doing. Where basically, it takes all those squiggly little lines and makes them into nice prismatic shapes. And you might recognize those hands there, those are actually mine. And to fill you in on a dirty little secret, I am no artist. So for this thing to be able to pull out those nice shapes from what I'm putting down there, it's really nice functionality. It's got a nice trim tool automatically integrated in there. And you can see that while you're on the go, being able to put down some sketches is gonna be a great productivity enhancer. Now, in addition to that, this portion right here is actually, this command is one of my favorites from Solid Edge ST10. And it's a really nice productivity enhancer as well. You might remember with Solid Edge ST9, we brought about duplicate component. And on this one, we have something called clone component, which basically takes it to the next level. Whereas on duplicate, you could go through, or duplicate rather, you could go through and you could place assemblies and sub-assemblies and associate them to other parts and shoot them around an assembly. On this, it takes it that next step, and it uses individual geometry to associate that new geometry. So you don't have to worry about whether it's on a separate part. You simply select what you want inside of the assembly, and you can have as many instances as you want throughout the entire assembly, whether on the same part or not. And of course, with that, you have some great options available to you, whether you need to suppress instances, whether you need to rotate your orientations, depending on how it comes in. You have full control to all of that whenever you use clone component. And what's even better than that is that all of these are individual instances of the part or of the subassembly with all of the assembly relationships associated to them. So, I mean, as far as productivity, when you have a lot of stuff that you need to get on there, this is king, right? This is going to be fantastic functionality for you guys.
Okay, so a couple things in there and a lot more stuff we don't have time to show. The first is that ability to naturally sketch and have it automatically convert to the shapes you need for real design. Some of you may recognize, or particularly our analyst friends here, and think, hey, Sketchbook has that kind of capability. We talked about Sketchbook last year. And that's exactly right. That's one of the great parts of being part of Siemens, is we have the ability to share technologies across groups and leverage those technologies. So we're leveraging the Sketchbook technology to achieve this natively in Solid Edge. The demonstration on the clone part stuff goes by really pretty fast. I think every one of you Solid Edge users needs to take a look at this closely. What it's basically doing is saying, if I put a part in an assembly, I can then look at features near the part and figure out other places where that part can and should go. So it doesn't have to be in any way a circular pattern, a rectangular pattern. It's going to look at the features in the model and find the other places where that part should go. It's kind of AI-like, it's rather magic, and it will improve your productivity dramatically. We also did some great stuff in synchronous sheet metal. We didn't have time to show that to you, but cutouts across bends that are dynamic, a couple other things there that I think you'll enjoy very much. Okay, next up is simulation. And in particular, this release, we want to talk to you about fluid flow simulation. So let's take a look at that.
All right, so those of you who have heard of CFD, computational fluid dynamics, what we're looking at here is flow EFD inside of solid edge, completely embedded. Now, you might be asking yourself, why is it called flow EFD and not CFD? That's because they changed the C to an E to stand for engineering. So the intent of this capability is for design engineers to be able to leverage it and utilize it, right? You don't need to be an analyst to be able to use this software. Now, the great thing about it, and one of the key aspects, is that you're walking through the initial setup using a wizard, right? So you don't have to manually go and input anything. You simply go through, set up the study parameters, and it's going to get everything from initial conditions to the parameters you need automatically placed in place. And then from that point, it's going to be just simply setting up the study itself. Now, one thing that I also want you guys to recognize, if we have any solid edge simulation users in here, that you're going to have a very, very consistent look and feel to how this is going to go. You have all of your study related commands up at the ribbon bar, just like solid edge simulation. You have all of your study parameters in the edge bar over here, just like solid edge simulation. And it allows you to walk through everything as far as setting up and establishing your study, your flow study. Now, of course, the primary aspect of creating a study is to make sure that you can validate your assemblies, make sure you can validate your designs before it goes into production, right? So being able to see the outputs of what's taking place is critical. And you can see here that our results can be seen in cut plots. So you can take little slices at any location inside of your computational domain to see what kind of temperatures you're working with, what kind of flow rates you're working with. And you can also do them in conjunction with one another, all while being able to leverage all of the visibility capabilities inside of Solid Edge. So you can see that we had the temperature on the motor where it's generating the heat, and then probably the primary output that people look for whenever they do flow is these flow trajectories. So you get a very realistic sense of exactly what's going to be taking place whenever it goes into production. So you can visually see how that air is going to be pulled in by the fan, how it's going to move across the motor, how that heat is going to dissipate throughout the entire enclosure whenever you work with this. And of course, it doesn't hurt that you get these beautiful rendered images and animations that you can use for your design reviews, or you can use for marketing materials. So it's a great, great functionality in the Solid Edge SC10 portfolio with Flow EFD and Solid Edge.
Yeah, so as Craig says, very excited to bring this new technology to you. It really is designed, it's not trying to take something that's an analyst domain and dumb it down. It's really designed from the ground up for an engineer to be able to use it effectively, do very complicated problems, but in an easy way. But it can also scale up to the analyst as well. So very excited about this. Next up is manufacturing, as I say. Very strong area for Siemens PL. And we have a lot more to show here in CAM. Sorry. Go ahead.
Appreciate that. All right, so the Solid Edge SD10 portfolio CAM solution that we're going to be taking a look at today, we're going to be dealing with a part from the needle assembly on the front end of the of the Bernina sewing machine. And for those of you who work with CAM, or those of you thinking about working with CAM, you'll soon realize that Solid Edge in itself is a great CAD tool to be able to set up and initialize your CAM studies. You can see that we're actually going to create our window frame support using our stock material, and Solid Edge is very quick for being able to pick up those shapes, create regions, and be able to drag that out. Of course, once you get the geometry that you're looking for your machining purpose, a single click takes it over into the CAM solution, where we've got some great new enhancements for the Solid Edge SD10 portfolio. The first is going to be adaptive milling or adaptive roughing. If you've heard of iMachining, this was an add-in that was for cost previously. This is now going to be free inside of the 2.5-axis or 3-axis CAM solution bundle. And essentially what it's going to do is it's going to automate the creation of your tool paths, right? So you don't have to worry about breakage on your tools, cutter wear. Nearly as much is going to get that material out of there, as much material as it can, in the most optimized way. And additionally, we've got some other great enhancements as well. If you have some geometry that you need to remove, or if you need to make sure that you maintain associativity between your parts, Solid Edge is automatically going to do that. Here we have some pockets that we want to remove from the part, but we've already got it into the CAM solution. We'll simply go and remove those pockets, delete them out, save your part, and then whenever you go back in to CAM Express and the CAN solution, it's going to automatically update all of those tool paths for you that's going to stay associative, so you can rest assured knowing that you have the latest and greatest when it comes to the part that you're working in. Now, the next portion of this is probably, it's not necessarily the sexiest part of it, but it's definitely, if you work with CAM, going to be one of the most important aspects, and that's the post-processor located on the cloud. For those of you who work with CAM, you know that whenever you get ready to send your part to a CNC machine, you need instructions, you need G-code to go along with it. The problem with it is, depending on the machine you use, they all speak different languages, they all have different instructions that go to them. This is a cloud-based collaborative portal where you can go through and get your post-processing done on the cloud, depending on what machine you want to be using, and post them up there yourself if you create post-processors, or be able to leverage this particular portal for your own uses. So some great new enhancements with the Solid Edge ST10 manufacturing enhancements for the portfolio.
Super. Yeah, so continuing to build out CAM, and we do have that unfair advantage of being able to leverage the Siemens PL portfolio for CAM, and really being able to bring great new capabilities to our customers, whether that's the high-speed roughing or other enhancements. This new cloud-based post, I think, is kind of a sleeper kind of thing, where it's something, if you don't do a lot of CAM, it may not be obvious, but the bane of everybody's existence is post-processing. You get all these tool pads, now I have to post it to my machine. Where do I get this post? How much is it going to cost? Having a marketplace for posts is a game changer, and we're going to continue to build that out. All right, next up is Tech Pubs. It's a completely new area for us, and I think virtually every Solid Edge user in the room can take advantage of this, being able to create those technical documents. So let's see how that works.
And this one is also a lot of fun to work with. I had the joy of getting to learn this go around. But essentially, what you have access to is a Solid Edge technical publications solution, and that's going to be two products of illustrations and 3D publishing. What you're seeing on screen is 3D publishing, essentially building out an entire document. Right? So what we're working with here is putting together work instructions for a motor removal process that we want to deliver to our customers, right, for the Bernina sewing machine. Now the great thing about this is that the technical publications, whenever you export it and then bring it into TechPubs or 3D publishing, it's going to have all the information carried across from bill of materials, configurations, exploded views, PMI views, everything associated to it is going to come across with the model, or, as you see here, you can simply create the exploded views yourself on the fly and then create imagery or 3D interactive experiences directly from that. Now, of course, the great part about this is that with these interactive parts lists and with this export that you have, you're going to be able to reach all of your customers using industry standards. So 3D PDF, HTML5, whether you want to do hard copy, whatever you want to work with, your customers are going to have access to this without having to download any add-ins, any plugins. It's going to be plug and play. Pull it up on your browser, you're going to have full access. And as you can see, the output that you create is beautiful. Vector images, nice clean lines, zoom in and out, rotate, whatever you want to do with those interactive parts lists. It's really a game changer, and it's going to be a great piece of functionality that you guys can leverage now.
Super. Thanks, Greg. So very exciting stuff there. I'd invite every Solid Edge customer to take a look at it a lot more carefully. There are two packages that you can add on to Solid Edge. The first, as Greg said, is Solid Edge Illustrations, and that is primarily for creating illustrations. If you then use some other publishing method, you want to make illustrations to put in Word, for example, or something like that. And then Solid Edge 3D Publishing is the full-on complete documentation solution, whether you're creating user manuals, part catalogs, and as Greg says, recently we added support for HTML5, so you can create fully interactive web content. I think you're going to find a lot of uses for this, and we look forward to seeing how you use it. All right, next up is data management. Whether you're 2 seats or 200 seats, we have a solution for you. And let's take a look first at the 2 seat end. Let's say 10-ish seats of Solid Edge, this might be a great solution for you.
So this is Solid Edge data management. If you were around at ST9, you would have recognized it as built-in data management, essentially something that comes free with every version of Solid Edge that you get, and we just continue to make it more and more powerful. Right. So the first thing we want to look at is a new command available inside of data management called get latest. And essentially what that is going to do is it's going to go and interrogate your model, and it's going to find all components inside of there with a later revision. or it's going to find all of them with different revisions. And here we have our clamps there that are going over the bearings that we placed using the clone command, where we have a version with a slot rather than two holes that we want to add in so that it has a little wiggle room. We simply select the geometry we want, and then it's automatically going to place that latest revision across the entire board, right? So just a single click, it's really cool. Now, on top of that, when you go into get latest, it's going to show you every component that has a different revision or a later revision available. Now, we saw up at the top with these handle supports or these handle clips that there was a later revision available, but we're not sure if we want to use that yet or not. We're not sure what that entails. So we have this revisions command that's been added. We've got a beautiful preview where you can go through and you can see the entire complete revision history of all of the parts that are going to be associated to that geometry. You can see which one you want to use, and one click, you have the entire thing replaced, making sure that you have the proper parts inside of your assembly at any particular moment in time. Now, carrying on from that, we've completely enhanced the Save As dialog whenever you're working with built-in data management. This is a CPD, Common Properties dialog, that essentially we need to make a change to that bracket up there. We're having some interference problems. It's going to automatically create a new part name or part number for us. It's going to recognize that there's a drawing that goes along with it. It's going to carry all of that information over and automatically save that part as a new one, right? At that point, we let Solid Edge do its thing, right? We need to make the changes, simply select the geometry. We need to associate for this clearing right here, so we can simply do a parallel face relay to move that out of the way quickly. We've got the changes we need to make, and that's going to reflect inside of the assembly. Now, the cool part about this, and this is small, but this is one of my favorites as well, want to find the drawing to it? There's a new open drawing button where you just simply click on it. It's going to pull that drawing up for you. You can update your views. It's going to pull up all the information. You can see we've automatically filled out all of the new part information associated to that part itself, and we've made sure that we've maintained the integrity of that part as well as the part that we saved that off from. So great new enhancements for that. Now, not only have we made a lot of enhancements inside of Solid Edge itself and working with data management, but we've also enhanced Design Manager and added a new command in there that I think you guys are really, really going to like. And that is a command called find duplicates. And what this is going to do is it's going to interrogate your entire assembly, and it's going to find any duplicate files that you have in there. Now, I'm not just talking about file names, but I'm also talking about geometry. If it's the exact same geometry, it'll find it even under different file names. It's going to give you the information on what drawings are associated to what. So if you have two of the same thing and one has a drawing, you want to use that one in the top level assembly. So a very, very intelligent command to make sure that, you know, whenever you're set, getting your inventory set up, you don't have two different bins of the same part, making sure that your bill of materials is proper whenever you output your design. So some fantastic new enhancements and built in. Best part about it, Dan, yes. Turn it on with the click of a button. It takes you through the rest of it. So it's very easy to set up, very easy to use, and I highly recommend getting your data in order if you don't already.
Super, yeah. So before I highlight a few of the new things in there that Greg mentioned, just to level set for the whole room on built-in data management. This, I think, is revolutionary for the smaller customer, small business, let's say 2 to 10 cents or so. We took a look at the way PDM is done, or data management is done, with smaller customers. And the complaint we get over and over again is, you know, I don't have any IT staff. Even maintaining an SQL database is a big pain in the rear. I have to back it up, I have to keep it groomed and all these things. Gosh, I just can't deal with that kind of stuff. And I understand that because small businesses have a lot of stuff going on. So I put the challenge out to my team and said, what if we could build a built-in data management system that didn't have a database? But yet, you could do instant where used, you could do instant property search, you could do all the things that PDM does. And of course they said, well, that's impossible. But then they did it. And so that we introduced it first in ST9, and it is really pretty magical because you can do everything that a PDM system does, but you do not need a database, and therefore it simplifies your administration by an order of magnitude. New in ST10, some very great things there. First of all, the enhanced revision management, so you get the full revision history, which is very important typically. This instant access to the drawings, recognize that drawing doesn't need to be anywhere near the model. It could be in a folder somewhere completely different, and because we can instantly do those searches, say, find me the drawing, it'll find it wherever it is in your vault. The other thing that I think is really important here is what Craig showed on find duplicates. So the other great thing about getting your data in order is when you become a larger customer and want to go to Teamcenter, the first thing you're going to have to do is get your data cleaned up. And it can be a little bit of a painful process. The biggest problem that most companies have is you have at least 10 duplicates, probably 100 duplicates, maybe 1,000 duplicates of the same part. And you think you don't, but you do. And so what you find is all your assemblies, some are using this part, some are using this other part. They're ostensibly the same, but it's not a healthy place to be. So the first thing you have to do is find all those duplicates and remove them. In ST10, we have an amazing fuzzy logic thing, as Craig was talking about. File name, geometry, timestamp, seems similar. We can go find those duplicates, you can clean those up, and so you're more prepared to scale to Teamcenter in the future. So it's really great stuff in ST10.
And it's so easy to use.
Customers are using this already. Folks like Bird Technologies, Bird makes handheld electronic equipment, and they're using it really in the full way that it should be used. So one of the great things about not having a database is it means that you can use tools like Google Drive or Dropbox between different sites, and your data can be replicated from one site to the other site, and it all still works perfectly. There's nothing complicated to do. You simply, your vault is Dropbox, or your vault in their case is Google Drive, and they work between multiple sites very easily. You still get all the instant search and everything else. All right, but then, if you're a larger customer with more complicated needs, we'd suggest Teamcenter, and we want to show you some of the new things in Teamcenter.
All right, so we continue to try to push to give you the best solution in the mainstream arena for connecting into Teamcenter and working with your data on their servers. And ST10 has been a paramount release for being able to do that. The first thing you're going to notice is our file open dialog. We put a lot of work into it, making sure that you have all of the information you need whenever you're looking for your parts, your assemblies, or even non-solid edge data, as you can see through these filters. No solid edge data, all the solid edge data, parts, assemblies, sheet metal, doesn't matter what it is. Now, of course, on top of that, we have a nice preview so you can see exactly what parts you're working with. And then you see these flyout menus, advanced search options, revision rules. Do I want to open up my last working version? Do I want to open up my last released version? You know, how do I want to manage this part that I'm opening? Different assembly options, such as configurations, as well as just all of the information, all the metadata that comes along with it, just to make sure that you're getting the parts you want through this file open dialog. Here we'll just simply search and find our frame design that we're going to need to complete for this particular example, because we got some really cool stuff that have come into play with Active Workspace as well. Now, those of you who don't know what Active Workspace is, it's phenomenal for working inside of Solid Edge when you're associated to Teamcenter, because it gives you access to all of your Teamcenter database material directly inside of the Solid Edge UI. Now, for those of you who have worked in frames in Solid Edge before, you know the methodology for that is you get a cross section, you have a path, it's going to sweep that frame along that path to create your parts that you need. Now, since that itself, that cross section, is not a part, it needs to be searched for using classifications. One of the new enhancements in Active Workspace for Solid Edge ST10 is it now supports classification creation and search. So you can simply look for frame profiles and then move through whatever filters you need to be able to find the parts that you need. Here we're simply going to be looking for some ANSI round tubing. You've got a whole plethora of different filters that you can use. As we scroll down, you see we have wall thickness we want to look at. We have diameters we want to look at. You know, if there are specific properties that go alongside with it, we can search on that. Here we just want to use or find a 2-inch round tube that we can use to finish up our design. And of course, since we're not going to just simply drag and drop this into the assembly because we're using this to sweep along the path, we need to have the link of where this is located inside of our Teamcenter area. So we can simply copy it to the clipboard and then go and create our frame just like you would unmanaged in Solid Edge. You simply search for it, you paste it from the clipboard inside of the frame cross-section area, make sure it's what we want, and then simply select the paths that you want to sweep it along, and it's going to allow for that creation, right? So being able to classify your parts, create new parts, and add them to the classification list is a huge enhancement with the Active Workspace. We never even had to leave the Solid Edge UI to accomplish this tasking. So some great new stuff in the ST10 portfolio with Teamcenter integration.
Thanks, Greg. Yeah, so to put a bow on that, the Active Workspace integration to Solid Edge, which came in a release or so ago, has really allowed us to do the deepest integration with Teamcenter. Right in the Solid Edge window, you see these things. So for example, now doing classification and such with Teamcenter. We also added, you didn't see it here, but it's really powerful, a work offline capability where you can say, okay, well, I need to take my Teamcenter data, I need to take it offline for a bit because I may be traveling and I'm gonna make some changes to it, and then be able to put that data, plug it right back into Teamcenter, have that all work very seamlessly. And of course, we continue to work on the user interface, make it better and better. And then finally, we're also offering some very, very price attractive Solid Edge Teamcenter bundles. So if you're looking to get into Teamcenter, now is a great time to do so. We see our customers who are using the Solid Edge Teamcenter interface really starting to leverage it very deeply. In this case, customer, again, it's funny because a lot of customers, Solid Edge customers, are not household names, but they make the machines that make household names. So SCM, for example, in Italy, they make amazing woodworking machines. And you say, well, what's a woodworking machine? Well, probably, if you're IKEA, you will know the name SCM because you create all that cabinetry and such on SCM machines. So really a high-end woodworking machinery manufacturer. The classification, very powerful for them and other customers. All right, last up is the Solid Edge portal, a new way to collaborate. So I'm here to tell you, this is the news announcement, is that this whole notion of emailing around drawings and emailing around parts and such is over with the Solid Edge collaboration portal. Let's take a look at that.
Yeah, so the Solid Edge portal is a very exciting thing that we've been developing, that we're going to continue to develop on, which is essentially a browser-based, no install, secure view and collaboration tool for all of your Solid Edge or non-Solid Edge files that you have. Create your projects, load them up onto your portal space, give people access to it so they can go and view it as well. You can see, you know, full touchscreen integration. You've got a beautiful viewer there, beautiful renderings out the backside. And because it is browser-based, it doesn't matter what OS you're using, iOS, Windows, Android, Mac, it doesn't matter. You're going to have access to it. You're going to be able to pull it up on any device that you want to and be able to leverage this capability. So, really nice stuff. Very excited to see where this ends up as we continue to develop on it as well.
Yes, so I think this is going to change how you interact with your customers. So today, I know most Solid Edge customers need to either work with a supplier or work with their customers. Very often, you create a design, you need to share it with the customer, get their feedback. One of the things you didn't see, this was actually a fairly early video of it, is markup. You know, complete capability to mark it up, put comments and so on to your customer, or vice versa. So you can securely upload things to this portal. Your customer logs into the portal, can mark up and say, well, I'd like this a little different, and they can then return that data to you. This is all without emailing anything around. So if you think of something like a Dropbox, but take that to the next level and say, sure, it's secure and I can upload my files, but I can also completely view my files with just the browser. I don't need anything else. I can mark up my files with just the browser. I don't need anything else at all. Now, that's the explanation to all of the Solid Edge users in the room. For the industry analysts, this is a multi-tenant, auto-scaling AWS implementation.
Thank you.
So, very excited about it. It is going to be it's going into private beta this month, and I think we're going to find a lot of uptake with this. Okay. So let's bring this to a close, or at least my section, mine and Craig's section. Think of Solid Edge not as a CAD system, but as a portfolio of products. As you see, we've just been building out this portfolio in a very extensive way. We continue to invest very heavily in design, next generation design, whether that's generative, reverse engineering, additive, the convergent that pulls all that together. I think you're not going to find a design system that's more complete in the world, honestly. Adding into our simulation capabilities, the flow technologies, bringing a whole new way to do that. Continuing to build out manufacturing depth. Brand new products for technical publications, whether that's Solid Edge Illustrations or Solid Edge Publishing, 3D Publishing. Data management, whether you're either 2 seats or 200 seats, we've got a solution for you, including starting with 2 seats and then getting to 200 seats. And of course, we continue to have lots and lots of apps that are built upon Solid Edge that you can take advantage of. So that's Solid Edge ST10, and I look forward to seeing what you guys do with it. Thanks so much.